Well, I want to welcome everybody again. This is, how many is this now of the working group? Is this like the third working group?
Nobody knows.
Nobody knows. Well, again, it depends on which element or which iteration of the working group we're talking about. So this is another in a long-standing relationship building operation. So we appreciate, again, everybody's participation and your being here, and also very much appreciate the participation of some of you who have been kind of rolling up your sleeves and working on, as we described the last time, a set of problem statements. I think it's important for us, and again, it was important this morning, and I want to reiterate it to the whole group. The reason we're here is not necessarily because we like to see each other on a very, very frequent basis, but it is to try to make our way through what on the surface might seem like a fairly simple issue or simple set of challenges, but in reality, all of the things we all face are emanating from some fairly complex kind of interaction on a number of fronts. And again, they obviously come to a head within the retail world. As has come to our attention, and one of the reasons we're extremely vested in this process is that we are attempting to learn and discover and work with the retail industry, prosecutors, local government, to understand how some of the kind of the typical operation of our law and regulations impacts, you know, kind of some of the very real operations that retailers face, some of the very real challenges that prosecutors and local governments have experienced in the real world of day-to-day operations. But most critically, is there a place for us to identify areas where we have agreement, even in a sea of, or kind of in an array of areas where it doesn't seem like there's a lot of common ground? But is there a way for us to find a place of agreement in a lot of these challenging areas that we can then try to marry kind of various public policy goals and objectives and the operations of retailers and manufacturers of products? Essentially, you know, we could have rolled up our sleeves or rolled up our wagons and said, you know what, the law is the law, deal with it, which is, I think, in large part, a lot of what we have currently. There's been a lot of prosecutions on the face of the current set of law, and I think that has had, good, bad, or indifferent, some fairly significant effects on behavior. You know, and I think as we've looked at some of these issues, one of the major impacts on behavior is there is an evolving conservatism in decision making. Decisions that were previously made about, you know, unsold products decisions are having specific effect, and things are being managed in certain ways, which may not necessarily be the best alternative that we would like to see accomplished. We're seeing a lot more things handled as waste, things handled as hazardous waste, which may not necessarily need to have been identified and managed as hazardous waste. So I think as a public policy objective, we don't need to burden our hazardous waste system with things that don't need to be in it. That said, we also want to ensure, and as a regulatory agency, as a DTSE, we want to make sure that wastes which are hazardous are appropriately managed in the end. We have a charge. We have a mission to ensure that public health and environmental protection are accomplished, and that hazardous waste is appropriately managed in that system. So how do we marry this, the operations of an industry, which has, you know, typically you wouldn't envision, as we've talked about before, you don't envision in the traditional industrial generator of hazardous waste sort of world. How do we try to help adapt or help at least understand the challenges and issues of the unique operations of the retail industry in a paradigm which was largely set up around, you know, manufacturing and generation of hazardous waste in the traditional sense? So we have invested, and we continue to invest. And again, if I can recount, this morning I think we had a fairly significant positive experience, you know, in terms of finding common ground. And you know, we are looking at this array of, and I think we've described it before, there's 8 different subject areas or topical areas that we've been focused, ranging from donations of usable saleable products to recalls, safety recalls and other sorts of recalls, looking at the issue of manufacturer's credit or the issuance of credit by manufacturers to retail for unsold product, recycling and the recyclability of unused products, the challenges of making waste determinations and hazardous waste determinations, some of the nuanced issues within the hazardous waste determination arena of the criteria that we apply, so toxicity criteria, and specifically the aquatic toxicity criteria. Some of the other challenges is just management of wastes at the retail end associated with, for instance, with partial or empty or partially empty containers and how that affects operations. And then finally, looking at the issue of donations. Does this system account for, accommodate, allow for the donation of useful saleable products? And if, and how has some of the application of law and requirements tended to influence that behavior of donation? This morning, we took on what you would assume would be a fairly simple topic. Donations. Do we all agree that donations is a good public policy? Do we want to see usable product, kind of used for its intended purpose? And do we want to afford the ability to see, charities and others who need these products, which would otherwise be thrown away, used for their intended purpose? And, you could be frustrated with government because we do the simple things the hardest way, but at least we had kind of came to the epiphany in this particular setting of, yes, there is a common public good that is served. So now it's starting to peel back the onion of how does the current state of regulation of law, the application of that decision-making matrix, who decides when, who decides what is donated, who decides and when does it become understood to be donated, or alternately, when you send something for donation, when does it somehow fall back out if somebody makes a decision later that, I would have liked to have donated it, but the circumstances aren't really allowing me, so does that impact of calling it a waste translate all the way back up to the front of that system for the person who first sent it down that path? And so this morning, I think we had made a lot of good progress towards at least coming to the common understanding of what is the acceptance and acceptability of that pathway of donation. What are some of the kind of the conditions or parameters around which we could agree? The types of things that we think should be eligible, kind of a clear path for donation, and the things that probably shouldn't be, the sorts of system requirements that should be in place, and at least we started touching on some of these things. But again, we were able to, and I think, made a good progress at framing. And so, like I said, although it from the outside may seem like, gee, you guys spent a lot of time and energy talking about, coming to consensus about a consensus item, but I think it gave us some good feel for how we are approaching these as a group. Because as you might imagine, there are a vast amount of opinions, perspectives, interests represented in this group and for many who have an interest in this issue. And I think it's important for us to spend the time to come to resolution. And again, we chose to take maybe the simplest first, because sometimes gaining consensus around the simple gives us then a platform to build on. And again, as a group, the number of years we've been together, we needed a victory, just on. Yeah. We needed something we could kind of hold up and say, yay, we have something positive to show. And say that kind of tongue in cheek, but also kind of half serious. So the idea is, and I think a lot of the discussion that we had this morning kind of identified for us some of the things that Jay will be talking about later in a few minutes, which has to do with some of how our California law operates and kind of the framework, kind of the landscape within which all of this is operating. And again, more critically, it's while yes, our law and our regulations are designed to ensure that hazardous waste is appropriately identified and managed, there may be, and again, how we can construct this forum and dialogue to understand whether or not there are unintended consequences in the operation of that law and regulation, and also how we can ensure that kind of competing public policy goals and objectives can be balanced. Because it's in some respects, and I think a lot of this is learning for us as well as for the folks that are in the discussion, how these things come to play in that center of all of our operations and interests. So again, I applaud the group this morning for coming to the simple answers, although it was somewhat tedious. I also apologize to the group for the tediousness that I introduced to the discussion as well. I ask sometimes the obvious question just because I know the answer to the obvious question, because sometimes that obvious answer needs to be put out into the mix so that people all are speaking the same language. So it's my silly technique, and forgive me if it's, you know, frustrating to you. I can tell you I've got a lot of staff who do not appreciate my technique either. So if you can join their club too. But like I said, my hope is that we've kind of formed a kind of a foundation and a framework that we're going to focus on some of the rest of. And again, we're going to take these things on simplest first and start digging deeper into the more complex. So again, the donations we talked about this morning, I think we got a lot of good feedback. We're going to be modifying that problem statement. Forgive me, are all of the problem statements that we're talking about, are they all posted online?
No,
not yet.
Just with the steering committee.
Just with the steering committee so far. So again, our desire is to make sure that we're getting moving through this as quickly as possible to get written work product out there so we can get the entirety of the group participating in feedback. We also don't want to kind of splinter this conversation into many different directions prematurely. So the first one we were going through, donations, we're going to get that one modified and get it into shape where we feel it can be shared with the larger group. The next item that we've identified to focus on is recalls and safety recalls. Because, and again, we're taking these on somewhat, there is a method to our madness. The idea of recalls, there is some other public policy objective. There is some other intervening regulatory requirements that come into play. So it's trying to, as we can see, those public policy objectives kind of coming in the center space. Then we're going to kind of dig deeper into some of the manufacturer's credit, which is going to get us, I think, into all of our favorite topics, David Irie's so-called kill codes, the idea of things that are definitely destined for disposal, but have some other intervening sort of management standards and credit that's assigned through from the manufacturer for those things that are not sold. And then after that, we're going to take on the easiest ones of all, the hazardous waste determination of aquatic toxicity. It's like my candy. I save it for last, you know, dessert. And just so you know, I brought my statement of reasons for our Chapter 11, Title 22, with me because that used to be kind of a constantly referred to. So if you ever want to know what's behind the scene of our hazardous waste criteria, that's the document you need to have. It's the Grail, the Holy Grail. So I think it's generally available on our website, but again, the idea is if you want to know the department's reasoning for why we did what we did and why we do what we do, it's available there. And you know, that actually that's kind of the substance and what we would hope to kind of inform the dialogue for some of these other topics. With that, before I leave too far the topic of donations, we do have somebody here I'm looking right past you. And forgive me, I don't know your name, but I'm going to bring you up and you're going to introduce yourself. So,
sounds good.
We have got somebody, you're from Walmart, correct?
No, I'm actually from Good 360. We're a nonprofit.
Okay, Good 360, a nonprofit. So as we were talking about donations, we thought we've got somebody here who can speak to us a little bit about kind of the importance of donations, kind of how the donation system operates. And before I go step out into obligating you to say very many things that you may not be prepared to say, I'll bring you up. And
thank you. All right. So, thanks very much.
Sure, you're welcome.
Thanks. My name is Sherry Rudolph. I'm part of the executive team of a national nonprofit called Good 360. We're headquartered in Alexandria, Virginia, but we do work all across the United States and actually all around the world. We've been in operation since 1983, and in those 34 or so years, we've moved about $9 billion in product to people in need. So we have a network of over 50,000 nonprofits registered with us across the country. About 3,300 of those nonprofits are based here in California. And we work with those nonprofits on a day-in, day-out basis to get them products that they need to further their own missions and mandates locally in their communities. So our nonprofits serve everybody from families to children, to the homeless, seniors, veterans, victims of disaster, and everybody in between. You can imagine that with a membership of about 50,000 nonprofits, that we're serving a very diverse group of organizations, and in turn, those organizations serve a very, very diverse and important set of purposes and provide absolutely critical services and programs to people in need. So I'm thrilled to be here today, and thanks for giving me the floor for just a few minutes to give maybe a little bit of an additional context, bit of context around why it's so important to have a really strong ecosystem around the flow of goods for donations and what we do with those products and why they matter to the people who ultimately need them. So last year, 2016, we moved about $400 million worth of goods, primarily here in the United States, and like I said, to a wide variety of organizations. That included hundreds of semi-truckloads full of lots of different kinds of products. That included tens of thousands of cartons that come out of our warehouse in Omaha, Nebraska. And it also involved the partnership of nonprofits with retail locations all around the country so that we can affect a local donation program as well. I was really heartened to hear that this morning the discussion was really productive and there seems to be some great movement. This is an area obviously that's really near and dear to our hearts at Good 360, but also to the hearts of all of our stakeholders. And we have a really major vested interest in this, not just as our organization, but also given that, in fact, we represent so many other interests across the country. So if I can take a couple minutes here today and just give you a little bit of extra context about, like I said, why this really healthy donation ecosystem is incredibly important. Hopefully it'll fill in maybe some of the gaps for you and give you a sense of where these products ultimately end up and how they're actually used. So one of the issues that I know is a big concern, not only for us, but for our partners, our nonprofit partners, but also for the retailers that we work with and the donors, is how do we know we're getting the right products to the right people? How do we know they're actually getting things that we need? So if you look at the Good 360 model, like I said, we get products to people in a few different ways. We can send an entire semi-truckload of product that we get from a donor to large nonprofits that we know can handle those. We also display all of our donations on a carton by carton basis on our website. So we operate basically an e-commerce site, if you would, but it's not open to the general public. It's only open to our registered nonprofit members. So they can order from us exactly what they need. If they need a box of shampoo, they get a box of shampoo. If they need a box of shoes for kids, they get a box of shoes for kids. They don't get a mixture of things that maybe they need, maybe they don't need. And that's really important to us because we want to make sure that we're putting the right products in the hands of people who actually need them and that we're not cluttering the system or we're not pushing somebody else's problem somewhere else in the system and making it an even bigger problem for those deserving organizations and for those people who ultimately will use that those products at the end of the day. We have a very rigorous vetting process at Good 360. So to become a nonprofit member of Good 360, you have to submit an application. We verify that your 501c3 is in good standing. We verify your financials so that we know you can actually afford to bring in these product donations. And for every step that you want to take with us to grow your engagement with us, it's one thing to order, like I said, a carton of shampoo on the website and have that delivered. That's pretty straightforward. But when we get into moving semi-truckloads of donations around, we need to make sure that our recipient organizations can actually handle that. So they go through additional levels of vetting in order to get more significant levels of donations. So we need to do just the basic things, of course, like making sure that somebody actually has a warehouse and a loading dock and that they have forklifts and they're able to actually move this product around. Something really basic, but we vet our nonprofits to make sure that they are all in compliance with what our requirements are for being able to move these donations. So there's a, like I said, a really rigorous process for vetting our members from start to finish. And as they grow with us, they go through additional vetting, including looking at our financials to make sure that we're not inadvertently working with them or putting them in a place where they can't actually afford to fund some of these product donations that they're getting. A couple of other points that I wanted to make too is that where we're at right now in the state of California specifically is that we have a lot of unmet demand, frankly. There's a lot of, you can probably sort of figure this out just very top of mind, thinking about, well, what are the most in-demand types of product categories that our nonprofits are looking for? No surprises. They're looking for things like clothing for sure, but a lot of nonprofits can actually get clothing donations locally, right? You clean out your closet, you take it down to your local assistance league, and they get a lot of support that way. What they don't get are things like personal care items. They don't get shampoo and conditioner. They don't get toothpaste and deodorant. They don't get rubbing alcohol. They don't get things like lice treatments that may be needed for children so that children can actually go back to school and continue to be educated. Those are the kinds of things that again and again end up on the top of our demand list. And right here in California at the moment, we have tremendous unmet demand on part of the nonprofits for a lot of those product categories because the regulations have been stringent enough that a lot of our retail partners actually put restrictions on us saying that we cannot bring those donated products back into the state. So we do have 3,300 nonprofits registered with us. Not all of those can actually source product from us though, because we might not have product available that we can bring in. One of our largest retail partners, we actually have a relationship with them in their return center in Nevada, just across the border. But all of those truckloads, dozens of semi-truckloads, just with our donation program, those products all go somewhere else. So even if the return products go to that center from California, those products wind up being distributed to nonprofits in places like Nevada and Arizona and even further afield. So what we're really excited about is if there is agreement on how this entire ecosystem can work together better and that there can be a good understanding of how these different product classes can be treated. Obviously, it's great for Good 360, but it's really, really great for the nonprofit ecosystem here in the state of California and all the people in need that are served by organizations that are doing good. Products like personal care items that I mentioned being at the top of the list, it's not just about providing people in need with those items on a day-to-day basis. We also work with a lot of organizations that focus specifically on things like disaster recovery. So think about the wildfires in Southern California recently. Think about the wildfires more up here in Northern California in the last 18, 24 months. So many people are displaced from their homes and they literally leave with the clothes on their backs. That's it. They don't have toothpaste, they don't have deodorant, they don't have the shampoo or the shower gel or the soap that they need for those few weeks until they can get back into their homes or, God forbid, months or years before they can rebuild their homes. So there's a lot of really important reasons why getting these donations moving and making sure that the retailers have the opportunity when it's appropriate to donate these products here in California is a huge benefit, not just to the organizations, but also to the folks that are in need. We have folks here in California, well, across the country, actually, who are actually willing to pay the shipping to get these products. That's how valuable they are for them. Because like I said, these personal care items, in particular, cleaning products, those things that get used up, they need to be replenished, right? A pair of shoes might last for an adult for a few years, or a winter coat might last for a few seasons, but these are the kinds of items that have to be replenished on an ongoing basis. So there's always a need for them, and like I said, there's an everyday need for them, but then there becomes very specific points of when they're needed when you talk about things like disaster recovery and kind of extenuating circumstances that happen to come up. One of the things that I think that Good 360 provides as a value, not only to the retailers, but also to our nonprofits, is that we can work with a couple of things. We can work with our donor partners, provide them with more education about what's the best way to donate products. How do you know that you're actually donating products that people actually need? And we do actually turn down donations if we don't think that there's a need for it in our network. Or more to the point, if we reach out to the network and nobody says that they actually need something, or at least not at that point, then we will turn down donations. So we're not stuffing a channel full of donations that can't be used. But what I think is an interesting thing to keep in mind, too, is that it's important to ask the nonprofits what they need, because sometimes it's not really clear. You might think that something is garbage or waste, but when a nonprofit with limited resources looks at it, they may have some really creative ideas on how to do that, how to work with that product. So, for example, we work with a fantastic nonprofit in the East, in Florida, and they've partnered with hotel chains. They bring in the very lightly used hotel soap bars that we're all familiar with and we all hate to leave behind because we use it once and then we figure it goes in the trash. Well, this nonprofit figured out, yeah, that's kind of a big problem, and that's a real waste. So where I would maybe look at that and say, well, that bar of soap, clearly I touched it, I've used it, it can't be used again, it needs to be thrown out. This nonprofit has developed a process to reprocess that soap, to kind of melt it all down and sanitize it, sterilize it, and form it into new bars of soap that can then go to people in need. So one example of just, you know, how creative some of these folks are in being able to use the resources that they have at hand. And we rely on our networks to really tell us kind of what they need, but then also how they can use the things that we have. And we've been amazed at the way that they use bathtubs as planters and turn that into an opportunity to teach people about sustainability and growing their own food, right? It's a bathtub, but now it becomes a planter and it's growing pea plants. It's fantastic. So I really appreciate having the opportunity to chat with you for a few minutes. I know I don't want to take up all of your time this afternoon, but I hope I can at least leave you with a couple of main messages. One, that this flow of donations is incredibly important to so many organizations and so many individuals around the country. There's over 1 million registered nonprofits in the United States. So even with our membership of 50,000, we're just kind of scratching the top of the opportunity here. And we're looking to grow all the time too, to be able to bring more and more product to people who need it. So the value of the donations, absolutely incredibly important and critical. The value of donations here in California, we're still not doing all that we can be doing here in California. So we're excited to be part of this conversation, even on the periphery, and happy to provide any insight or any information or knowledge from our side on how we see this unfolding. So that's, I think, the highlights for right now. And if there's any questions, happy to take them.
Terrific.
Great. It's the easiest thing I've ever done. Thank you. Appreciate the time.
Sure.
Thank you.
I think it's going to be critical to have folks like Good 360 really in the conversation, because I think the system that we need to look at and contemplate, it relies upon a number of operating partners, and that's kind of the criteria that are used from every direction, I think, is going to be vital to kind of giving everybody the assurance that we're looking for. So again, appreciate the information. Yes, we will have questions. So, we may not be peppering you right now.
Okay.
But there are many that I've already jotted my list, but there's a number of things that I think will be helpful to kind of bridge and kind of marry the front end with the back end. So, I think for our purposes, what we want to make sure is, and kind of get your insights as a kind of an operating entity, and kind of the sorts of the issues that we as a regulatory agency are concerned with, which is the sham, the thing. Mm-hmm. Somebody sends it claiming that it doesn't. So, obviously we're very interested in kind of getting your insights, right, and experience in that arena. But again, I'm only touching on the surface, and I promise not to go down my list, but I won't go any further down my list. With that, I think it's the promise of the dialogue this morning. I think we'll continue to build momentum on. One of the things we wanted to do today primarily is to kind of look at kind of walk through this kind of the state of our regulatory system, which ultimately influences all of these transactions and kind of creates some of the challenges, some of the kind of has cast the pall, has kind of created the kind of the corporate climate that has we found is having the influence on the California market. Again, risk aversion, all of the things which are kind of understandable in a corporate culture. I think we wanted to understand how all of those pieces come together, but the basic underpinnings for all of that is our statute and regulation. So, and Jay's provided, and we'll go through a very good presentation, a number of scenarios which I think help us to understand it and put it into context. So with that, I'll turn it over to Jay Cross. He's one of our assistant counsel, or it's one of our counsels. Yes, I'm sorry.
Rick, can you just, are we going to do roll to see how many new people are here from the morning so we know how big the work group is?
Do we get sign-in, Matt, on who all is participating?
We have not.
We typically don't do roll of this group simply because there are so many kind of externals. We do keep a list of the working group members.
People who are here, but as far as those calling in, no. We don't. I have no idea.
Okay. So it's just we typically do an open line. So
we do a sign-in for here?
Yes, we will do a sign-in for here. Okay.
No, we didn't. We did the roll call.
We did the roll call in the morning. You're here. Thank you.
I was here this morning, too. I was late.
And contrary to popular belief, I'm here. So you are my alibi. So Jay, with that, and one of our councils with our Office of Legal Affairs and DTSC works with the DAs and others in helping to develop cases. So he's one of our experts in this arena. I rely on him heavily. So Jay, with that, have at it.
Thank you. Too late to back out, huh?
Too late to back out now, unless you want me to give your presentation.
Good afternoon. My name is Jay Cross. I'm an attorney with the Office of Legal Counsel here in the DTSC. We just wanted to kind of set up, I guess, some foundation and some basic information as to how HWCL works and how we function, so that we can kind of get on the same page and maybe understand the same terms. What do they mean for DTSC? Maybe there's some differences with what it means to you. First of all, HWCL, we have statutes and regulations in Health and Safety Code 6.5 and our Title 22, so pretty easy. So the foundational issue is a material that's non-sellable, is it a waste under HWCL? I remember when we first kind of started meeting, there was a huge room downstairs, and I think Byron Scherer, one of the coastal rooms, where we came up with three big questions. Is what's a waste? When is it a waste? Is it a pharmaceutical waste or is it a hazardous waste? And I'll try to get to the first two. I don't think I can get to the third. And I think that involves a lot more issues than we're prepared to handle right now. Waste. It's an item that's been discarded. I mean, if you think about it, what is a waste? At our homes, what's something that you throw out? I think it's the easiest thing. That would be a waste. In the manufacturing setting, we look at a manufacturer brings in raw products, and they make a thing, a new product that they're going to sell. In the process, they use different raw materials. Some of those raw materials may be not end up in the final product, but they're used like a solvent or alcohol or even just raw materials, but they're not used, so they tend to be become something that we would call waste. Manufacturers take a raw material to make it a product, but some of it may no longer be usable. Some of it might end up being contaminated. Some of it may undergo some sort of chemical change or physical change in the process of making their product that they can no longer use it. So that would end up going into the waste stream. So the first question is always whether or not something is a waste. And if it's something that you're going to discard, then it's more likely it's going to be a waste. Something might be recyclable or reclaimed later on. It's still a waste. So basically, something is a waste when it's discarded. I think that's the easiest way to define it. So if you have a recyclable item or recycled item has been used or will be reused or reclaimed, either on-site or off-site, under 25.124b2, that would still be something that we would consider a waste. A regulated waste can include items that are stored or accumulated or treated before they are recycled. So this goes to the question of when does something become a waste? If you're going to discard it, but maybe you're not going to discard it right now, but you're going to accumulate it until you have enough to fill a drum. Well, in general, when the first drop that you put into that drum to dispose of it, that would be something that you start counting that as a waste. A regulated waste can include items that are stored or accumulated or treated before it's actually going to be disposed of. So you have something that's a waste. You can have it recycled. You can have it reclaimed. It has some value. It's already a waste. If you're even just going to, well, one of the things that can happen to it is you can just have it incinerated or thrown into the landfill. And of course, that would be a disposal. So under our Title 22, 662.61.2, a waste can include items that are reclaimed, as I said before. And it can also include items that are stored or accumulated before they're reclaimed. Waste can also include items that are stored or accumulated or treated before they're recycled by being used in a manner that constitute disposal. So if you're going to recycle it by using it, then that would still be a waste.
So hold on, Dave. You just packed a lot in one sentence. What is use constituting disposal?
So use constituting disposal. Let's say, for example, I have a truck load of fertilizer that is going down the street, and the truck breaks down, and the fertilizer gets dispersed into the soil, right? Generally, what do you do with fertilizer is you disperse it into the soil. So that may be something that you would consider a waste, but it's going to be, you can use it through disposal. You can use that contaminated fertilizer and use it for its intended purpose and put it in a field where it will fertilize that field.
Another common use for that term is where a waste is incorporated into a product. So incorporation into asphalt, which comes into contact with the ground, is essentially, by our regulations, assumed to be a use constituting disposal. It looks like use, it looks like a product, but it's because it comes in contact with the ground surface or has the availability to migrate into the environment. So all of these are very easy to understand concepts, except that the devil is always in the details. So right. The idea is a use constituting disposal is something which comes into contact with the ground that is essentially, even though it doesn't look like a waste, is a waste.
It's a waste, right. So a waste can include items that are accumulated speculatively. So, and I'll explain that a little bit more later on when we go into our scenarios. But basically, if you are, let's say you have a manufacturer and they have some solvent that they can still use. They may use this solvent several times in their process. So they're saying, well, you know, it's not yet a waste because I can still use it and you're accumulating it. But let's say, for example, that same manufacturer is accumulating and accumulating and accumulating all this waste. And they're saying, well, you know, I still have some use for that, but they never end up using it. Well, that kind of might lead to our thinking is that, well, that's probably a waste. It's kind of like those, you know, a person that just hoards things in their facility and says, well, I'm still going to use that paint, drum of paint. And it's 10 years later, oh, yeah, I'm going to use that. There's a question, was that a waste at that point? So, so the next question is, once you've determined whether something is a waste, and again, the main key thing is it something that they're discarding or disposing? That would be a waste. The question would be whether it's hazardous waste. And if it's a hazardous waste, then it would fall under the hazardous waste control laws. So under the Hazardous Waste Control, HWCL, a generator is required to characterize the waste for its hazardous potential. And it's either flammable, corrosive, toxic, or it's a listed type of waste. So those are kind of the main things that we look for. If it's a listed waste, there's actually a list on 66262.11b, where you can see that something is listed and it's basically would be a hazardous waste. There are excluded wastes that meet one or more hazardous characteristics. If it's toxic, reactive, ignitable, or corrosive, these are characteristics of the material itself. Some of this information can be found in MSDS or SDS. Some of this information can be found just basic science, chemistry. You know, if you have a hydrochloric acid, of course, you know that's a corrosive. If it's sodium hydroxide, you know it's a basic type of corrosive material. So if something meets these hazardous waste characteristics, they would be a hazardous waste, and generally they would be a recro waste. So in our discussions, one of the things we wanted to do is, okay, so the main key as to whether something is a waste is whether it's discarded. There may be different facts to look at to see whether or not it is a waste at that point. If it's expired, if it's recalled, if it's something that has become illegal or is illegal, if it's damaged, if it's off specification, if it's missing a label, or it's leaking, those kind of things. So generally, when you have a product, you, as a retail, oh, yeah. So when retailers, their main function is, of course, to sell to the consumer, right? When you sell to a consumer, there's, well, you're selling to a consumer. That's what you're doing, right? What you have is a product. So that would not be a waste. Sorry, this kind of changed a little bit on me, but
oh, no.
No, it's all right, it's all right.
We do this, keep on toes.
Yeah, okay, so here's the first scenario that I wanted to talk about. Let's say, for example, retailer one wants to sell a pallet of flammable material to retailer two, right? He wants to get, he has non-moving product in his facility, in his office.
So
or,
all the aftershave?
Right, or aftershave.
He thought was going to be big, but then.
So he's, yeah, so basically he's got.
Is that what you were looking for?
Yes, okay, that's the one, okay. So, for example, retailer one decides to sell to retailer two. This is a direct sale. Is there a sale of a product? Retailer two then would sell it to a customer, and retailer two could also possibly discard. Let me start over.
Yeah.
Okay, so here's a scenario. We have a material. Let's say it's aerosol cans or flammable liquids. Let's say paint cans, flammable paint. So you have flammable paint that's in retailer one store. They can't sell it for some reason or another, and they want to move it from their stock. They can, of course, they're trying to, their primary purpose is to sell it to the consumer that comes into their store, but then they can also sell it to another retailer, or they can sell it to, or move it to another store, another location. Is that a waste? Would be the question, right? And I think we can all agree it's not. They're just moving product from one store to another, or they're selling that product, that pallet of flammable paint, to another retailer. Now, let's say, for example, you sell that product, retailer one sells that product to retailer two. Retailer two accepts it, tries to sell some of it, but it's not going very well. Maybe they sell one or two drums or one or two packages, but then they still have almost half a pallet of waste, of product. Okay, so they still have half a pallet of that product that they decide, you know, I want to get rid of this stuff, right? So the retailer two is the one that's discarding it, that's going to be discarding it, and they can send it to a landfill or an incinerator, or they can try to give it away. Is there an issue with that, right? So if, who is the generator of that waste? Should we go back and say, well, retailer one was the original source of that material. Should they be the generator of that waste? And I think we could agree that no, they're not. Okay, right? Because it's what retailer one sold to retailer two is still a product. So in a similar scenario for donations, as I said earlier, in our meeting this morning, if retailer one decides to give a product to a charitable organization, that charitable organization can then sell it to the consumer at a reduced cost, or they can just give it away outright. But then what if they find materials that are, you know, they can't give away or they don't have a place for? Who would be the generator of that waste? Would it be retailer one? Or would it be the charitable organization?
Charitable organization.
Right? So in most cases, I would say that, yeah, it's likely that the charitable organization, who is the one that decides to discard of something, is the one that's the generator of waste. But then, you know, in both of these situations, the retailer, the first retailer that donates or sells the product to somebody else, he transfers ownership from retailer one to either the charitable organization or retailer two, is not the generator of that waste because they're not selling waste. They're not giving away waste, but they're giving away product. But then there's the other part of it that we, that's, this is kind of where we're concerned as well, is that, well, can you give away hazardous waste? And as we, you know, as there are many examples where you can say that hazardous waste, they have a value to it. There's stuff, there are things in the hazardous waste that you can reclaim. There are, in some cases, you can get credit for them, as we've discussed. But if it's already a waste before you sell it, then retailer one would still be on the hook, and they would still be the generator of that waste.
Can you say that again?
So, all right, let me go back. So if a retailer has a product that they're selling or giving to a second retailer or a charitable organization, then what happens afterwards doesn't go back to retailer number one.
Right.
Because they're not the one who decided to discard that waste, mm-hmm. right? It was the charitable organization or the second retailer that decides to do that. However, if, for example, retailer one has this pallet, and included in that pallet is some hazardous waste, whether it was used substances or contaminated material or broken or leaking or, you know, something that we would suggest that that's a hazardous waste, and they sell that or give that to a charitable organization, well, they would still be the generator of that waste, and they would have to have managed that as hazardous waste.
May I ask a question?
Sure.
So does that mean that it really depends, that is that making sure that retailer one has liability for passing on something that should have been waste and wasn't really sellable, it wasn't a product?
Right.
Is that the where the safeguard is?
Right, because,
okay.
You know, if can you sell waste? Yeah, I mean, there are people that actually buy scrap metal and waste and stuff like that for recycling, for reclamation, because there's value to it. Your electronics, as one example, is that, you know, there are people that buy and sell in that field. But can somebody just go ahead and receive that? Can a second retailer go ahead and receive that? In our case here, for example, one of the things that we've been talking about is the reverse distribution center. So in reverse distribution, if let's say retailer one sells to retailer two, they're selling product. Can they have an intermediary like the reverse distributor be in between them, retailer one and retailer two, to process that sale? There's nothing in our laws and hazardous waste control law that would stop that from happening. However, if it's already a waste before it is sold to the second retailer, then that's kind of where we get into trouble. Because for a reverse distributor, they would have to be able to have some authorization or permit to be handling, accumulating, and storing that hazard, that waste. Okay. So when the retailer sends it to the reverse distributor, is it a waste? There are different facts that we can look at. Generally, if you are accumulating hazardous waste, then you would have to have a permit or authorization to be able to do that. If your retailer is already accumulating hazardous waste at the retail site, then that should already begin to be managed as hazardous waste. Not clear? Okay. Question, Rick?
No, I'm processing the
one sounds like. Okay. All right. Well, I don't want to get into that recall thing, but okay. So are there any questions on that? Sorry if that wasn't as clear as it could be.
I think what's unclear is what makes it a waste prior to sale to the second retailer or prior to donating it.
Okay.
And that's the part that I don't think you have,
right.
have addressed.
And there are different things that can give us an idea as to whether or not it was a waste already. One of them is if the material's expired. There's kind of a suggestion that, well, if it's expired, then it's more likely a waste than it isn't, right? If something is broken or leaking, well, that's definitely a waste. If something is subject to recall, that is more likely going to be a waste, right? Because if they're, you're shaking your head.
Not necessarily.
Yeah, why? I'm sorry?
Why?
Not we'll go through that later.
Right.
But here's the thing. If it's subject to recall, again, that's one of those facts that you're thinking, well, if it's subject to recall, because for what reason? Is it being recalled because it's dangerous, because it's off-spec? Is it just being recalled because they want to just reformulate the material, or they want to put out new product? So there's different things. So not necessarily everything that's recalled is going to be a waste right away, right? But you have to look at all the facts, and you have to look at the totality of the circumstances of why something might be a waste or why it wouldn't be.
So yeah, I would put it, if there's any factor which would indicate that it can't be used as is for its original intended purpose. So if there's something about it's illegal to sell or continue to use, so somehow, some way, there's a reason it can't be as used as a product as is.
If it's dangerous.
Right. So I mean, some of these issues are going to have kind of mitigating factors that come into play. But the idea is, generally speaking, if it can't be used as a product, there really is a lot of reason to consider it to be a waste. And even if it, okay, so this is where for charitable organizations and others, where we're trying to ensure that somebody is not just offloading or dumping their particular, something that can't be used by anybody else, or there's, you know, it's dangerous or has tampering or other things, like that's the fact and fact pattern was coming into play. It'd be interesting to hear how much product dumping occurs in the charitable donation realm, for instance. How much of this, you know, unusable or waste kind of makes its way into that system.
Right. So one other factor could be if something is illegal. Let's say, for example, fireworks. Here in the state of California, there are certain types of fireworks that are allowed to be sold in certain areas, but not in other areas, other locations. There's the safe and sane fireworks, and then there's the type of fireworks that go up in the air, which are illegal here, but they may not be illegal in another state.
Illegal aerosols. I mean, ARB has a lot of product standards for VOCs, and there have been occasions where illegal product has been brought into California for sale. So therefore, it can't be sold.
Contraband deodorant?
Contraband deodorant, okay. Or paints or pesticides or this. So, I mean, unregistered pesticides. So, I mean, there's a number of factors and scenarios that I think that kind of describes where it's not legal to sell here in California. And obviously, the desire would be to kind of, can we ship it out of California and bring it to a legal location?
What are you saying about that? Saying that if...
I didn't have an answer for that. We want to know.
So, for example, no other state, as far as I know, has Prop 65. So, if something could be sold here without a warning, but it could be sold in another 49 states, is it a waste when it comes to a reverse distributor in California, or reverse distributor who could then sell it?
Well, if the retailer is saying, "I'm going to get rid of this. I want to discard this," then it would be a waste. But if he's saying, "I'm going to sell this somewhere else where it's legal."
So the test really isn't whether it's being collected for possible resale someplace where it is legal.
Right. But if, for example, I'm saying to Mr. Vista's distributor, hey, you know what? I've got all these shampoos or whatever. Oh, gosh, shampoo is such a...
Bottle rockets.
Okay. So I've got all these things. I want to send it for disposal. And I'd like to send it to my reverse distributor so that they could collect everything and then ship it off in one fell swoop. That would be a hazardous waste already, because he's already at that point, the retailer's already decided, I'm going to discard this stuff, I'm going to dispose of it, and he's asking you to collect it for him to dispose of it, right?
The reverse distributor. But I understand
that
position.
So if he's asking the reverse distributor to accumulate and store this waste and then dispose of it, well, that's a management of hazardous waste, and that would already be a waste at the time the retailer decided, I want to get rid of this stuff, I want to discard it.
But how often would a retailer have an illegal product that shouldn't be sold in the state of California? You know, if it doesn't have its Prop 65 warning on it, or it's a firework that's not legal in the state, I would assume that most of you in the retail world would make sure that product didn't end up in a store in California.
Well,
Yeah, right.
In the Prop 65 case, a lot of people, I mean, you find out when somebody, when some. When you decide, hey, it's part of the settlement, I'm not going to argue this, so I'm going to take it back. I mean, we could talk about Prop 65 all day, but there's a lot of things that get recalled under Prop 65 that a lot of people would say are not illegal, but that's the resolution.
Yeah, Prop 65 doesn't imply that it's illegal, it can still be sold.
It can't be sold without a warning.
Right, can't be sold without the warning, that's, but if that's why it's getting, if that's why it's getting back to the reverse distributor to get rid of it because you've got it on the shelf and doesn't have the proper warning, and that's probably the manufacturer's fault, but regardless. You're saying it happened.
An example would be VOC levels. California has incredibly
complicated
strict VOC levels in every kind of product.
Yeah.
With billions of goods being shipped, occasionally a case might come into the state that isn't formulated properly for California. You can, as a retailer, take it out of the state and sell it somewhere else. I mean, the obvious.
Okay, so it does happen.
Is that a waste or not? Nobody.
Okay.
Right. Well, in that case, if your retailer is discarding it, then it would be a waste. But if you're not discarding it, but you're just going to sell it somewhere else, then it's still a product.
Prop 65, they should just put a sticker on the bottle and they find out they have a problem. So easy.
Yeah, and that's kind of where things get a little bit more complex, right?
The difficulty is, where is that knowledge? Who possesses it? How is that decision brought about? I think maybe the bigger point in your point you're trying to make, Jay, is it's the intent, but when does that intent kind of come to bear? When is it realized? And when is that knowledge kind of under? What is that knowledge?
Right. I mean, there are certain circumstances where I think it's obviously going to be a waste. If it's broken, leaking, and it's damaged, it's not sellable, it's not usable anymore, it's contaminated, it's, you know, there are all these things that, you know, you can put on an item and to decide, well, you know, that's just got to be a waste. There's no way around it. You can't donate it, you can't sell it, you can't give it away, you can't reuse it. Yeah.
A few meetings back, somebody brought up the example that drops a bottle in the store and trying to reuse it in the store. What you just said now says that's a waste, even if it's the same product and used the way it was intended, even though it broke on the floor.
Okay, so let's say I'm a retailer,
right,
and I have a open a bottle of Clorox or bleach. Let's keep Clorox out of it. An open bottle of bleach, right? I can still use that for cleaning. I'm not discarding it. Right, because I can still use it in my store. I can clean up bathrooms or whatever surfaces using that bleach. It's not a waste.
But if somebody dropped it on the floor and
it
spilled,
if it
and
dropped,
then picked it up and used it the way it was intended, is it still a waste? Is it a waste?
Spill a clean the floor.
That's a well.
You're
not discarding anything.
A strong argument that if just the package is damaged, dented, and unsellable in its current form, but they're using it for its original intended purpose, and it's not uncommon for
materials
to be used in the store for cleaning.
Yeah. Yeah, I drop the bottle of bleach on the floor, it spreads out, and I use it to clean the floor.
Yeah, I mean, where it gets a little stretched is where I'm going to use it for dumpster deodorant. Something like that. You know, it's like, I want to make sure my dumpsters are very clean.
Use Sherry's example of the slightly used soap or slightly used shampoo in the hotels,
mm-hmm,
to collect that and to use that for any purpose would be a waste.
I think there's a strong argument to be made that it's not usable in its current form. You can't sell it in its partially consumed state. There has to be some form of kind of reclamation that takes place. So I think the strong argument there would be, yes, it is a waste. The question then becomes whether or not there may be some other pathway,
right,
that might be available to it that may be excluded or otherwise allowed, but...
And I really mean that example, because I thought that was a brilliant thing to bring up, is what happens to all those soaps right now?
No, I get it.
Exactly.
They go in the trash, whereas this, at least the curve, what you laid out, there was a use for them, but now hazardous waste management standards go around them, which makes it nearly impossible to do. So it's a policy issue where I understand the law, but the result is perverse.
Right. Understood. And like I said, some of what we're trying to accomplish in this group is to kind of tease out some of those sorts of consequences, which may not necessarily have been intended or serve a purpose, but also to understand and put them in the context of, you know, in that arena of behavior and activity. What defines the thing that we think is okay versus where it could go wrong or be abused or stretched, so that somebody wants to make that claim, yet, you know, doesn't have kind of a purpose in mind that is in line. So, and it, obviously all of these discussions are good, kind of coming at it from all of our different perspectives is absolutely essential, because these things are best understood through scenarios, through applying it to circumstances. Nothing,
sure.
No offense, Jay, but you know, I mean, the law is not necessarily, but for practitioners and those who kind of gone to law school and made a living at this, you know, are excited about reading legal terms and definitions ad nauseum and legal case law. It's not necessarily helpful to kind of bring us to that common understanding of kind of how this applies and how we can proceduralize this and make this effective. It's important. It's absolutely essential because it defines the liability. But for us to kind of understand, come to some common ground, I think it's understanding it, but also how it applies.
So, one of the things that I was looking at when getting ready for this was, you know, whether something has value. And I think that's something, a topic that's kind of been brought up a lot. If something has value, does that make it a waste?
Or does that not make it a waste?
Or does that take it out of the waste category? And I have to fall back to, what is a waste? If it's something that you're going to discard or dispose, then that would be a waste. Even if it has value, if it's something that you are accumulating or storing or, you know, getting ready, putting together so that you can later on dispose or discard it, then that would make it a waste.
I mean, we in EPA have often been asked whether that value quotient becomes
is now joining.
I think we have a long-standing practice of not taking into account that value statement simply because value is transient. Like something, the monetary value of something will change through a transaction. I'm describing practice and history, Scott. The idea though is, because even a recyclable material can be viewed, even something that's clearly a waste to the person generating it, you know, may have some value, but that value in commodities markets and other places may be fluctuating. So on one day, it's got a high value. So you could argue on this day, what, it's not a waste, but then the market depresses. And now it costs me more to send it off than it does, than it has the shared value. So on that day, is it a waste? So again, because of the transient nature of that economic value, we have not kind of, you looked at that true tale of a specific factor to consider. Whoever just joined, if you could mute your phone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, go ahead.
I understand. I mean, you mentioned EPA, so I have to disagree with you.
Okay.
Because I think, as many people in the room know, there's guidance from the beginning of RCRA, 1980, where, and as recently as, you know, when EPA came out with the proposed rule, they said our policy has been to recognize credit transactions are not waste. And so I understand that you take the same words and you interpret them differently, but let's
Okay. So I think we may be talking two different aspects or elements here. So,
okay.
So it may be that both are true and accurate statements. Again, so in a credit transaction arena, so I mean, I think you're taking my statement and kind of again, shooting down the path towards a particular application that we'll be talking about.
Stop.
But in a general sense, as we have looked at other waste transactions for recycling and other sorts of potential markets for waste in California, we have not tended to give that or lean towards that valuation in that transaction as being a determiner for whether it's a waste or not. Just because money changes hands doesn't necessarily mean it wasn't a waste.
Rick, I think you said EPA, and Scott is saying Fed EPA.
Yes, we take a lot of our guidance in practice from Fed EPA. So it's not there are particular instances where that may not necessarily hold as absolutely true, and I would grant you that. So it's,
okay.
I'm just trying to give you a generalism before we talk about it in more specific.
Thank you.
I think most of us know that the department has a long history with speculative accumulation that failed. You know, whether it's used drums or what have you.
Yes.
And we're not trying, I think, anybody in this room to change the general rule. What we're saying is there's a subset or related issue for credit accounting purposes that hasn't been addressed, and it hasn't, you know, shown itself to be a problem, and we need to dig down to that.
Yeah, and
that's where.
And I will stipulate, and, you know, even in my preceding comments and historically on many occasions, that the rules that we generally abide by in the hazardous waste world were designed around a particular set of circumstances which may not necessarily have fully understood, accounted for, or accommodated some of the elements of this particular industry. So I stipulate that, however, that what that does not mean is that we can just simply ignore, bypass, or otherwise disregard
Correct.
Some of those very legal principles. We've got to figure out how do we navigate those now, and if there's a place where we can identify solutions, resolution, or agreement, how do we go about that?
So my takeaway at this point in the context of talking about donations is that if it is not a waste because it is not broken, compromised, illegal,
yes.
etc., that it can be donated and it is not a waste.
Without touching our hazardous waste regulatory system, I think that's a generally true statement. There will always be nuances and issues that kind of flavor that in terms of some other factors, which, again, I think those all revolve around those, that set of criteria that forms the boundary condition for, is it still a usable product? Is it still intact? Is it still essentially the same as and still has the same value and purpose as a product on the shelf? So I think in a general sense, I think that's an accurate statement.
Throw a little wrinkle into is a waste always a waste? In my case, and this is a critical issue for us, is if somebody throws something away, say like a fertilizer,
it's a waste.
And I can still use it, it's in the intact container, it's a hazardous waste.
I think because the inceptional act, that first act, it's management, into the waste arena, the difficulty of pulling it back out of that waste arena and into a usable product arena, I think that's the challenge of how we are looking at the legal system.
Okay, in our household hazardous waste programs, we have the ability to take something that somebody's throwing it away, like that fertilizer. When it comes into our facility, we make the determination it's still usable.
Yes.
We'll put it on the shelf, and it's no longer a waste.
Procedurally, you make a determination when it's coming in the door, which path it goes down. Is it a usable product, and can we continue to use it and put it on our materials exchange table for somebody else who has need for that product, or is it going down our waste path?
So even though the customer, the resident, intended it to be a hazardous waste, we can override that determination.
Yeah, well, part of it, too, is you're talking about more of a household hazardous waste facility receiving waste from a household.
Or a small business.
I think, just to be fair, we grappled with that issue tremendously with, as a consumer, the household, bringing something to a facility, which is designed specifically to receive waste. How do you pull it out of that waste, previously determined waste? I mean, the consumer or the householder already decided they didn't need it. The question becomes one of how do you intercept that decision path? And what we have allowed and what we continue to allow is that to be looked at as a product and continue to use as a product.
So in my LoCheck program from the garbage, takes something it finds in the garbage, takes it into the household facility, which it's allowed to do, they can then determine it's a material, not a waste.
I think that you're stretching me beyond any place I can.
It's not stretching, it's reality.
It's
it happens.
So taking it out of LoCheck,
LoCheck waste is allowed to come into a household hazardous waste facility.
And be separated into usable product?
There's no distinction. The regulations or statutes don't address that. It just says a household program can have a reuse material exchange program, and it can accept LoCheck waste. Add those two together, and I can reuse something from a LoCheck waste.
I think that's a leap that we need to talk about.
But I guess the thing, though, is I think we're all trying to figure out
head for the door.
How to get the highest and best use for these materials.
And I think that's what we recognize that. But I think one of the basic elements here is understanding the law and the regulations and how they apply and not try to.
Well, maybe they need to be changed, I guess is where we're going, right?
I'm not there yet, and I guess.
I'm just throwing it out.
And I think you've got a lot of hands in the crowd.
I'm sorry, my patience is thin at the end of a Friday.
No, I get it. But I've got an interest in, and I think others have an interest in, let's make sure we don't break something we need in the system, trying to find rush
totally
to
agree.
A solution.
So
I don't disagree. And I think one of the purposes for this discussion today and, you know, historically and in the future is how do we find those common goals and objectives that we can agree to and agree on? And if there are reasons or needs to change anything, let's figure out what needs to change, how we can do that more surgically and intentionally, and don't push it to an interpretive sort of massaging and gymnastics, which leaves us in a difficult spot at some later point when we don't, when that's going to complicate or compromise our ability to take action.
Can I ask, though, when do we get to that part? Because, I mean, I'm sorry, I haven't even been at all the meetings, but I'm already starting to hear things over and over again, and I'm just wondering, we're all very busy, we're coming into a very busy season, there's already a spot billing on this thing, and I would just love to start talking about where the exact problems are that we can potentially fix.
But I'd like to hear the rest of this.
Yeah, so again, I think one of the challenges we've had, Heidi, and I appreciate the fact that, I appreciate you're here, I appreciate the fact that we have had historically over the past few months, if not longer, kind of run into some challenges of acceptance that this is a problem that needs a fix at all. So one of the things we purpose to do is to kind of lay some foundational work to ensure that everybody who's part of this conversation may not necessarily all be present in the room now, but have participated remotely or otherwise. So we can all come to an agreement on that it is a problem, what's the nature of the problem, what the fix should be.
So there isn't agreement that there's a problem?
No.
Gotcha.
There has not been. We may be closer with one issue, but yes.
But just an observation to understand some of the frustration we on this side, which I think you do. While you say we need to go carefully, we need to be thoughtful, we don't want to break something. In the meantime, though, while these questions are unanswered and unclear, there's incredibly aggressive enforcement happening on our sector. Hundreds of millions of dollars of penalties, so it's difficult. You know, I know you want to go carefully to answer these questions, but these are questions we live with every day.
And I guess the only bounding, and I appreciate that, and the only bounding consideration I have is that as a group, we've attempted a legislative pathway already and have not met success. My purpose is to try to figure out how we can come together to engage that more successfully. And so I'm doing it the only way I know how. And so nothing about what I'm doing, what we're doing here today, prevents you from taking any other run at whatever, however you want to do it.
I was just saying that the reality is these are tough questions. Nobody really knows the answer.
Correct.
And that's a tough enforcement world to live in.
And I understand. I appreciate it. So some of this, though, kind of rests in kind of how this all operates. I get that. And I'm, like I said, you've got my committee. I've doubled down in this whole arena of trying to get us together through this process. And so, but like I said, nobody has to hack. You don't have to hook your wagon to this horse. It's got to sway back. That's really cool. Okay?
So just responding to the first question, if the retailer sends it to a reverse distributor for the purposes of donation, and, you know, it's not a waste under that circumstance.
And it's donated.
And the reverse distributor has it and can donate it, and that's not a waste.
Right. I mean, if
whatever the chain is,
if the retailer is sending it to the reverse distributor to donate it or to sell it to another retailer, it's a product. It's not. It doesn't ever come under our purview. However, if it's already a waste at the store, and this is kind of where the issue is it a waste at the store? Is it a waste at the, where is that point of generation where it becomes a waste? And generally, it's the generator is the first person whose act makes it a waste or decides to make that decision to discard something. So I can see, you know, the reverse distributor's point that, okay, look, my retailer doesn't know if it's a waste or not. They're going to send it to me. I'm going to make that decision. I'm going to try to sell it. I'm going to try to give it away, or I'm going to send it for recycling. I'm sending it for reclamation. I'm going to send it for incineration, or I'm going to send it for landfill. So you have all these choices, and maybe you may have other choices aside from those, right? So this whole arena then is basically saying, well, when is the point of generation? When did it become a waste? Was it when the retailer first sent it to the reverse distributor because they don't know what to do with it? Or is it when the reverse distributor looks at something, evaluates it, and thinks, you know what, I have a home for this, I can then donate it? Is it still a product at that point? So it would still really depend, and this is kind of where those kill codes, pesky kill codes come in, is that if the manufacturer had pretty much outlined that, you know what, whenever you get this product back, we want it to the landfill. We don't want you to sell it. We don't want you to give it away. We want our name brand to be, you know, at such and such a level that we don't want this out there in the market, not necessarily, right? So there may be other reasons. So, or they may say, you know, the bleach, the bottle of bleach that they get back. You know what? We can't reformulate this. We can't do anything more with it. It's just going to get disposed of. But we just want you to count it, or we want you to give us the appropriate credit. You see, whether you get credit on it or not doesn't change the fact, doesn't move the needle one way or the other of when it became a waste. It became a waste when somebody decided we're going to dispose of it.
Okay, so just, to, I think if we're going to talk about destroyed dispositions, let's talk about
sure.
the circumstance. So there is when we say destroyed dispositions, there's always a credit piece. Right, nothing's coming back just to be destroyed. The reason it comes back is to do a credit evaluation first. Mm-hmm. And we've talked before about what a credit evaluation is, and we can spend some more time on it if we need to today. But I don't want anyone to have the impression that things are going back to reverse distributors just to throw it away. Because as Michael pointed out this morning, that costs money and it's a total waste of money.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So there's something else that's happening, and what is happening is this credit evaluation. So I just want to make sure everyone understands that. You can't separate the credit evaluation from the destroyed disposition because they're the same thing. At least a subset of the credit is the destroyed disposition, but that it's always happening.
Right.
So it's never coming back just with the destroy. It's evaluated for credit. And although, as I started to say before, although you can, you know, people can take the position as you are taking that the credit evaluation doesn't matter. You know, that's not the position that EPA has taken, and that's not the position of a lot of people, because the credit piece is important. It's, you know, if you're looking at the intent of the retailer is, all I know is I can't sell it and I might get credit for it, and I don't have any intention to discard it until someone makes that determination whether it's credit worthy or not. Yeah. So if you're talking about what the intent is, I mean, you know, you can frame it as, well, your intent is to throw it away. I can frame it as, well, my intent is that it be evaluated for credit before that decision is made. And that, you know, that leaves us at a stalemate.
Well, and if you look at what's the risk to the environment, you bring us back to our fundamental purpose here. Is there a greater risk to the environment from receiving this product from the manufacturer and stocking it on the shelves, or sending it back to the reverse distributor for a credit evaluation if it's to non-leaking? And what difference does it make? Why are we getting so worried?
Dale Patton is now exiting.
Why are we getting worked up about this? Because the credit value motivates you to maintain the product and make sure that it gets there safely, just as it does the retail value on its way to the store. So to me, you put those two together, and I don't know why the department has an interest in trying to regulate stuff that still has credit value and, you know, is intact and being shipped.
Let me put it this way. I mean, I don't know that we necessarily put that. Number one, the waste definition doesn't have a credit value within it. But I think our interest is and has always been, how do we regulate hazardous wastes? We are coming in contact with and are kind of growing to understand better some of these other ancillary factors that come into play in this industry, in these transactions. That said, it still doesn't change existing set of law and regulations and how they operate. So what may be evolving here is at least opportunity for us to grapple with whether or not there's a place for a combination of this sort of thing. I don't know. You know, I think we have to. That's a multifaceted, multi-stakeholder sort of discussion that needs to take place.
We need to put our finger on what it is specifically about the hazardous waste law that the department feels is an impediment to creating credit value as, I think, de-wasting factor.
Other than EPA got past
it without, you know, much sweat for 35 years.
EPA does a lot of things. It's definitely a conversation worth having.
Yep.
I don't necessarily want to kind of put us into that particular arena because I think we set it up for next time, right?
Yeah. And also I'm leaving, so there.
I don't know. The last word, is it? I want to add two cents to that.
And that is, I'm a little bit concerned about how we're defining waste. I'm not talking about hazardous waste, I'm just talking about waste.
Just
because
waste.
You have to have a waste first that is going to, which my understanding is, and I was trying to pull up the definition, but I didn't successfully do it. But there is a legal definition of what is a waste.
Yes.
Something that's intended to be, it's going to be destroyed or disposed of, right?
Here,
there it is.
Okay.
Relinquished.
But I don't think that we can really characterize an item that is going to be donated or returned for credit or sold as a waste. I don't know how we do that.
We're okay on the bookend ones that you just said, but the credit is where we're, I guess, this is where we may not necessarily, we need to talk that through a bit.
Okay, well,
right?
If we're not talking about credit for something that's not intact. We're only talking about intact products.
Yep.
We get that, but ultimately if the credit is only being assigned for a purpose other than it, I mean, it's destined for disposal. It doesn't change its endpoint disposition. If there are subsets of that discussion, that's fine. We need to tease it apart. But ultimately what we're talking about is something that the retailer would otherwise dispose but for some other factor that comes into play, i.e. the manufacturer has some particular crediting function for ensuring that its product and product line integrity and all these other things would may come into play. But it's ultimately still, you're just intersecting it in its destination or in its path to disposal or destruction.
But I only see disposed of, relinquished by being disposed of, it's, you know, of course incinerated, other things, but it's discarded. You are not discarding something that you are sending to someone for a purpose of selling it, donating it, returning it to a manufacturer for credit. You're not just, that's not.
And that's
what
I
agree on two of those.
Discarded.
Yeah.
I've struggled with this for many years, all of us have. It's almost a temporal issue to me. Your concern would be, because it's going to be a waste sometime in the future, i.e. it's a waste now. In other words, for me as the retailer, I would say, don't throw that away. I do not want you to discard it. I want you to package it, ship it, put it on a truck, and send it to a facility so it can be audited for credit. I would say that's the opposite of an intent to discard it. But I think the issue we all struggle with is, because ultimately you know down the road, after all that activity is done, it will be discarded, you try to push that decision of discard forward. Every consumer product is ultimately discarded.
No, and I get that. That's clearly not what we're talking about. But if it is for those products which are being transferred back through the distribution system for purposes of gathering it to dispose of it, where that intent to dispose actually exists much further up. And so the question of whether or not the retailer knows or doesn't know and that sort of thing, it's like, I get where the challenge of information and an understanding of that. So again, I think ultimately as we discussed this morning, I think we're in agreement that something destined for sale is not a waste. Something destined for donation that is donated for its originally intended purpose, given the kind of the framing conditions we discussed, is not a waste. This one, this whole manufacturer's credit will be, and I think it's probably going to be kind of a fairly significant discussion. And I don't know that we don't have areas that we can come to agreement. I think from our perspective, we think that if it's destined for disposal in this process, regardless of the accreditation process, it's going to trigger our system. It's going to be a waste. And so then how do we deal with that?
The question is, who's the generator?
Right.
That is the question.
Whoever possessed it at the time the decision was made by somebody, that it couldn't be sold.
To discard it.
Well, again, if the manufacturer...
The definition is to discard it.
The manufacturer made a decision which then had impact on the possessor of the material at the time it occurred, right? So a retailer who has it in their possession becomes to know that the manufacturer says, I don't want that sold anymore, I want it brought back. Similar to a recall, only a different kind of set of parameters, but it has similar implications. So on a recall, would it be the Consumer Product Safety Commission that ultimately said it bears the burden and responsibility for the waste determination, and therefore they're the generator?
What you want is to make sure that the product does not end up being illegally disposed. If it's a hazardous waste, you want to make sure that it ends up in a hazardous waste.
Somebody who's prepared and designed.
The question is who in that reverse stream do you have sufficient confidence in to cause it to go to the appropriate disposal facility? And it seems to me that the retailer is probably less likely than someone down that stream.
And I get your point, Gene, but essentially, though, in our system of regulation, it has traditionally always been the generator, the person making the decision, bears that responsibility. And I'm not trying to predetermine, predispose, or otherwise drive this discussion in any particular way, but I think it's important for us to understand how the system operates so that we can understand where it's triggering our thinking, the regulatory thinking, so that we can come to some resolution, or at least start identifying areas where if changes need to happen, where might those be made, and what would be the best changes to make? Because wholesale exemptions, we're not keen on, because ultimately there's a whole lot of things that go into wholesale exemptions, and they also have the tendency to drive behavior, just in the same way our little system drives behavior, some of it unintended. Other changes may also have other unintended consequences. I think we just want to have a chance to map it out before we jump quickly. Heidi, sorry.
So if they can donate to a charity directly, that seems fine. If they give it to a reverse distributor, that seems to be where
is now exiting.
What's that?
Who donates it to a charity, that's fine too.
Right, but I'm wondering if there's an easier way for the retailers to know if we can certify the reverse distributor to accept certain types of materials where they are certified by DTSC or whatever to deal with it, that they know I can give it to them and I know they're going to do the right thing. The state's okay with what they're doing.
I think you're fast forwarding to some of the solutions offered the last time. Again,
I've had my hand slapped for that very reason.
It won't be the first or last time for us, I'm sure.
No, but you're jumping to a point of solutions that I think there's been discussion even in the bill last year. So I think some of this is because of the fate of the bill last year and what it attempted to offer as solutions, which didn't necessarily succeed. We're trying to kind of come back and lay some foundational work to see if that solution still has merit, but with some foundation work done. That's all. So I appreciate the dogged kind of.
Sorry, I'm just getting
single-minded view to get. It's like I don't want to waste time. Let's just get the solutions done.
Yeah,
I get that. But in the same way, another element of this discussion is, does the reverse distributor have the ability to modify, change, or otherwise pull something out of what was determined to be waste by a retail operation in the first place? Similar to the household hazardous waste collection.
You kind of biased the question when you put it like that.
Okay. Well, again, let's presume for a moment that a decision has been made by a retailer for whatever reason that they can't use this. It's going down the waste path.
Well, they see it going into the reverse distribution path, which is not necessarily a discard path.
So let's go down that path of maybe my scenario just is falling apart before my very eyes and I shouldn't pursue it.
But hypothetical assumes a fact that determines the answer.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, but again, I mean, it's similar to the household hazardous waste collection facilities where somebody's act, putting it in the trash can or bringing it to the household hazardous waste collection facility in the first place, presumes a certain decision kind of has been made already. That I can't use it and therefore it's not.
Yeah.
So there is some of that inference in when a retailer sends it off, but it made it, that's where it kind of falls apart in terms of its parallel structure.
But I would say if you stand at a landfill or a transfer station and you see what's coming in, it's disturbing how much is usable. So, I mean, maybe that isn't the right assumption to be making.
There's probably some work we need to do there, Heidi, on how we can ensure that we're not putting local governments and others at risk for things, common sense solutions, which may not necessarily have legal underpinning.
I mean, it's why we put reuse centers at landfills.
Can I make a suggestion? So I'm noticing the clock, and I noticed that you had a slide on recalls, and since one of the topics that we're going to try to talk about, I think in our next session, we said was recalls, I think it would be really helpful if we could...
I was going to skip through that. No, I'm kidding.
If we could get to your slide so that we have that
foundation. Yeah, I'd like to
foundation.
See the rest of this.
Yeah.
Sure. Before we discuss next time, I like that word.
So nothing definitive as to whether or not something is a waste or not a waste just because it's recalled. But these are questions that we would ask, right? Like I said, it's the decision to discard or dispose of something that makes it a waste. So just to kind of go back to this previous slide as far as reverse distributor things that are being sent, I can see a scenario which there's possibilities that kind of are worrisome as an enforcement and regulatory agency to me is that could a retailer say, I'm just sending my products to the reverse distributor and it's not a hazardous, it's not a waste. I'm just sending it back to the reverse distributor, and then the reverse distributor then would make that determination as to whether or not something is a waste, something is donated, something is resold. That's all I'm gonna say about that. But you know, I mean, I'm thinking with that scenario, maybe there is, but what kind of is troublesome for that is that if it ends up in the landfill, the question then comes, or in the in, gets up ends up being disposed anyway, or you know it's more likely to be disposed, then that kind of more suggests that it was already a waste when it left the retailer's location, right?
What support do you have for that? I think that's the crux of our discussion.
Yeah. Right.
What is the support that says that retroactively?
I think it would depend on the facts of that situation, of that case. If there are...
Airbags.
I'm sorry.
That's what you're looking for. Airbags fit into your scenario you're trying to help with.
Airbags?
Airbags, because you know those aren't going to be used.
Okay. There's no other use for it. It's just going to be destroyed or incinerated. Definitely something that's never going to come back into the stream of commerce, right? And nobody can reuse it.
Yeah. But Prop 65 doesn't fall into that.
Right. So what we're saying, and we put a hypothetical in our statement about this, there will be some cases where the fact that there is no other disposition is obvious.
Mm-hmm.
And there will be, so those sound like maybe the airbag is your example. The example we gave is, you know, there's something wrong with the aspirin. We're not going to, you know, reuse the tampered aspirin. A different example would be, well, there was something wrong with the label. So maybe you just take all the aspirin out and put it in a different thing, right? So you have those are your different examples of recalls. And then the question is, is that
now joining
the decision as to whether we're going to call it a waste on is how obvious it is what the disposition is? I mean, I think that seems to be what you're saying.
Is that
in some cases it's obvious that it can't be reused, and so therefore it was a waste of the store, in which case the whole federal regime for recalls, and somebody, Heidi, I think, sent me that very helpful bill.
Yes.
AB 1850?
1860, chapter 19.
Which I think is the policy of the state of California that manufacturers should be responsible for providing for a system for recalls to go back to them.
Yeah.
So you already have something in your laws here that suggests this shouldn't be done at the store. Manufacturers are required to provide for and pay for
provide for the safe return of the product to the manufacturer at no cost to the end consumer or the retailer.
Okay, that sounds like we're not expecting retailers to throw it away at the store. That's in your laws already. So whatever we do here, you would think we should come up with a system that allows that law to make any sense. And that's, I think that ought to be the focus of what we're talking about. And when you regardless, again, where the law is today, or what you, however you interpret this, we should try to come up with an interpretation that gives effect to that law. And I think that would put us on the right path here.
But that might not be a decision that can be made here. That may be a decision that you have to bring to the legislature.
Well, but I think one of our jobs is to maybe make recommendations where we think we need to.
Right.
So I would just introduce the bill.
Simplicity of a fix could be to just cross-reference or make reference to that particular section or area of law in our hazardous waste control law, kind of carve out a particular allowance.
And that would jive with the federal EPA law about, you know, creditable product. So there is two levels of support for that. And your policy position on, we are concerned primarily here in California regulators, that these products don't go into the waste stream, that they're properly dealt with, regardless of whether they're dealt with at the third party contractor, at the retailer, or at the manufacturer, they're properly dealt with. So that's your concern. It doesn't so much matter who deals with it as long as it doesn't go into the waste stream, right?
A bit of an overcharacterization for my position, but I understand your general point.
Right, I would agree with that.
Well, this bill addresses that. The bill would impose additional requirements on retailers of products determined to be unsafe, including removing the product from the shelves of its stores or programming its registers to ensure the product cannot be sold within 3 days after receiving the recall notice.
No, sorry, right. So I think that provides us a pathway to consider for...
Right, and that doesn't cover all recalls.
Just unsafe products, recall or warning is the...
Right, so
there's the unsafe piece. I mean, there might be other things that are... What's that?
Said warning. So it could be
right. Okay, but it could be something that's defective but not unsafe. I mean, sometimes people recall things because the thing doesn't work.
Not always.
That wouldn't make it unsafe. It just doesn't work. So we'd have to.
Right, and there are other recalls.
It's a faulty product.
I understand.
Yeah. So that's. But that covers a lot of the recalls.
Yeah.
But manufacturers recall product all the time. They essentially, for other reasons besides safety or those sorts of things. I mean, they just may want to discontinue and pull stock back because they changed labeling, changed attributes. They want to get their new product on the market, that sort of thing. Right? I mean, I don't know.
I just want to pick up, I guess, my notion of safe, of recalls would, I mean, yeah, we use that term gets used in a lot of different contexts. But I think what we would want to see is that we covered not just things that were unsafe, but also defective. Because I think you can be defective without being unsafe for things that don't work, right? I mean, you could, there's one thing between aspirin killing somebody. There's another thing if it just doesn't cure your headache. Those are not the same.
It defines recall.
Right. I saw.
Yeah.
And it was very helpful.
So, you know, I would even, and I'm not in the business world anymore, but I would even argue that if they just want to change the label for their branding, which I think is a very wasteful policy. I think their policy in a company should be sell it out and bring in your new label. But if that's the reason they're asking a retailer to send back the material, or, you know, it's a recall, I would argue that's still their responsibility. But I have a very blunt question. So say you introduce a bill in the legislature, and, you know, the manufacturer is going to be all over that. They're not going to want that.
Right? I don't know what.
They're not going to want all that responsibility put on themselves. And now you've got people.
It's
already
here.
It's
in the law.
It's already.
I know, but you're asking for a policy clarification. There's going to be pushback on that. Are you willing to take that on?
Well, all I'm saying is.
I would.
The policy is already here. And all we're saying is that we get to make it feasible from the hazardous waste control law standpoint. We don't let the hazardous waste control law stand in the way of manufacturers doing what they were already told they're supposed to do, which is provide for a system for taking it back. Because the current system for taking it back is largely not at the store level, because nobody wants to manage recalls at thousands of stores and make sure it's safe and effective and count the goods and all those other things. So I don't think this adds a burden to manufacturers. I just think it makes it clear that what they're doing now is okay, and it has this waste control law, it doesn't prevent it.
Yeah, it creates some consistency and without conflict in dealing with product. I mean, this law provides recall means any repair, replacement, or refund program. So it's pretty broad.
Right, and so I think we need to dissect that to kind of figure out whether, how comfortable we are with the breadth of how those two interact, that's all.
Glad I'm old enough to remember that we had this on the books.
We're glad too. Not the old enough part.
Is anybody enforcing it?
No, the question.
To the best of my knowledge, no. And that's part of
your point. And that's where I think you're going to run into problems, is they don't necessarily going to want this to work well.
It's probably already built into the contract.
I was ahead of my time.
Is it public resources code, is it?
Health and safety.
Health and safety.
What section?
Health and safety code, part three, division 104, section 108040.
As DPAs is a ring.
All right, so let's say, for example, something is being recalled. Let's say it's a pallet of aerosol cans that are flammable or ignitable, right? So we've got our pallet of aerosol cans that are being recalled. In our world, retailer gets notice, this stuff is being recalled. What's to stop the retailer from, at that point, packing it up, asking a hazardous waste environmental company to come in, pack it up, and ship it off for disposal?
Is that a real question?
Yes.
May I provide a real answer?
Of course.
They're wanting to make sure that the recall is safe and effective, and if you have that done at thousands of stores, how do you know you got everything? You're counting on thousands of stores to report, I threw away this amount, and I threw it away safely.
So Scott, help me understand then, is there a statutory or the regulatory mandate to ensure the recall is safe?
So I don't know about, I can tell you under FDA rules, you're not an FDA, because of your example. I don't think you're, well, it depends what your aerosol is, I guess.
Right.
But FDA has a requirement that the recall be safe and effective.
Okay, so.
And so I think that's interpreted to mean that I actually know what happens to this stuff.
Right, but in terms of, you know, for those particular products under that regulatory jurisdiction or authority, there is kind of an overarching mandate that defines the purpose, goal, intent, and
right,
the effect of the recall, and ensuring that the recall has had that effect.
Yeah, you have to say that it was safe, and I think that's what the word,
right,
safe and effective.
But then the question becomes, what is there similar for other recalls that exist that ultimately, are you marrying a mandate, or are you simply just trying to implement best practice?
Well, and probably both. I can find out what the standard is under CPSC, if that would be helpful.
Right, so again, because I mean, obviously recalls under specific authorities, to the extent that they define and have particular obligations, mandates, if we can identify conflicting legal requirements, that gives us some area to probably come to agreement.
And I don't know, I'm not saying that FDA explicitly says you have to do it in an aggregated kind of way, and you can't do the story. It's just that the practical implementation of safe and effective, I think most manufacturers have determined that, gosh, I have a hard time saying it's safe and effective when I, what do I have, like an email from thousands of stores telling me, yeah, I took care of it, all good? That's not the same as having secure destruction at a reverse distributor where someone's there and counting and take pictures of it. You know, so the practical interpretation has been, not that you can't do them at the stores, but that the best practice and the best way to feel comfortable and avoid liability for not complying with those rules is to go back through some kind of centralized process.
Okay.
So Jane, how many more slides do you have?
Thank you.
Hit the fast forward
button. All right, well, oh, sorry. Go back to... So one of the questions I had is, as far as I can find the recall. Okay, so if the manufacturer issues a recall, would they be considered a generator of that waste? Because our definition of generator is the person whose first act causes something to be a waste.
Yeah.
I think it really does depend, but I'm more leaning towards the fact that it's most likely the retailer that becomes the generator of that waste. Primarily because until the retailer takes it out of service or identifies the product and takes it out, that's when, and then they're going to discard to send it back, or ship it out for disposal, that's when I believe that it becomes a waste. But
I'm just, I have no opinion. I have a personal opinion, but it sounds like you do too.
Right.
That's when you think it might be.
Yeah, that's, again, just a personal opinion. I'm thinking it's more likely that, yeah, it might be on the retailer side. But then there's still an argument to be made that it could be the manufacturer that is the generator of that waste, because they're the ones who instituted, I want this back, who make that determination. So, and again, the subject of the recall, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to be a waste necessarily right away. But that's one of those factors that we would look at as to whether or not something is a waste at the retail store or elsewhere. So another question is, you know, the return to the manufacturer things. Similar to a recall, the manufacturer wants their product back, sent back to them. Maybe they're repackaging, or they're formulating another a newer strain or a newer brand or a newer product, and they want this old stuff out of there. Maybe it's just a matter of labeling. The question that, again, we would look at is whether or not, is there going to be a discard? Is it a discard at the time of the retailer, or was it a discard when the manufacturer wants it back? Some of the discussion that we've had in the past has been that some manufacturers have said, well, you know, we want it back and we can probably reformulate it and do something with it. But there's also been some talk that, well, the manufacturers can actually reformulate them. Once they get it back, they just take an accounting of it, and then they would go ahead and dispose of it. So it's kind of similar to that same situation we've been discussing. If there's already been a decision that's been made that it's going to be discarded, it's going to be landfilled or incinerated, then again, the point of generation would be at that point where they decided to discard it.
But one really critical distinction here is who's making that decision. In
right.
all your scenarios, it's the supplier or the manufacturer.
Right.
They're saying, I want the product back, and they're deciding what to do with it. I think they're clearly the generator.
Right. And that's
making the case for an extended producer responsibility model.
Yes.
I saw you leaving. I had to get it in.
Thank you, Rick.
Took the words right out of my mouth.
As far as recalls, is there any other issues you guys want to talk about? No.
We probably have a lot of time to talk
yeah.
about it at our next.
We're getting close to our time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. Keep going.
You can just run quickly through the rest of here so people can.
Okay.
Yes, Nick, we just have a sentence up there. Can I just ask a quick question?
Yeah.
Retrograde materials are a subset of it. Does that mean that the retrograde has that year period? So
yes.
Do
right.
you mean it would be
any
like
longer
or?
And again, things that are retrograde are allowed or out of our systems, provided it meets the conditions. So.
Right.
Okay.
It may just be a cumbersome way this was presented, but the idea
okay.
is retrograde materials basically return back to the manufacturer and be used within the mandatory time frame.
That's slivers of the pie.
Yes.
We're not getting 10 or 20 or 60% of the return to vendor, return to manufacturer reformulated.
And back
you
know, most
stories from businesses.
Yeah, most
that's
of our
occurring.
Yeah, most of our experience with a lot of the manufacturers are that they don't have the capability or capacity to take it back at their manufacturing location. It's just
the regulation does say manufacturer or owner as well. It's not just the manufacturer.
I don't have it.
I think that makes sense.
But Jay, the rest of these are really just hazardous
right.
waste terms and definitions. I see a lot of people are packing up.
Yeah,
it's supposed to end at 3. So,
oh, 3. All right.
3:30.
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
if you want to take another 5 minutes, if that's all right, just to briefly run through these definitions.
This
would
be useful to me.
Sure. Sure. So. We define a generator in Title 22 as the person whose act or process produces a hazardous waste.
Is now exiting.
A waste, again, means anything that's discarded material that's not excluded. Discarded material is further defined as something that's being relinquished by being disposed of, being burned, incinerated, or it's being accumulated, stored, or treated, and not recycled, but in lieu of being relinquished. So if you're putting something together, storing it, accumulating it, before you, you know, instead of disposing it, as you would probably normally do, then that would be considered a waste. Recycled or accumulated stored or treated before recycling, except as provided in 25.143.2 would also be a waste. If it poses a threat to the public or the environment, it's mislabeled. These are where the broken and leaking come in. So this is all pretty easy. Reclaimed means that a material is processed to recover a usable product or that is regenerated. Examples are recovery of lead values from spent batteries and regeneration of spent solvents. So recyclable material is a hazardous waste, pretty much. So a recyclable material can be a residue, a spent material. It's a material that's contaminated, except it can no longer be used for the purpose for which it was originally purchased or manufactured, or it could be a byproduct listed in the regulations adopted by the department.
But not all recyclable material is hazardous.
Well,
I mean, you wouldn't, paper.
Well, yeah. No, there are.
We're in this realm.
Okay.
Hazardous.
All right, fair enough.
This is
Completely different definition of solid waste recycling.
Right. So a recyclable material is also a retrograde material that has not been used, distributed, or reclaimed through treatment. And the manufacturer usually has one, or the owner has 1 year from the day the material becomes a retrograde material to do something with it. If the material is returned to the original manufacturer, that manufacturer then has another year of which to try to recycle that material.
Right. And I think the point that was made was, what does that for owner mean?
Right.
I think it's hopefully a pretty plain. Owner of the material is at what point? I think it.
Right.
Oh, that these things were clear in such plain language.
So recycled material means a recyclable material which has been used or reused or reclaimed. It does not include intermediate manufacturing processes, process streams. These are pretty much self-explanatory, I think. I'm not going to go through each one. Okay, so RCRA versus non-RCRA. Of course, you know, RCRA is federal, non-RCRA hazardous waste. We have in California. I think this distinction would be something that we would look at a little bit more, especially when we're trying to decide whether something is a pharmaceutical waste or a hazardous waste and falls under hazardous waste control law, right? If it's a RCRA waste, then it's a waste. If it's a non-RCRA waste, but it's also a pharmaceutical waste, then that item gets shunted to the pharmaceutical medical waste management act.
Notwithstanding some of the ambiguity and some recent changes.
Right. And there are still, yeah. So it's important to make a determination whether something is RCRA or non-RCRA. And I think that's also where the fish bioassay comes in. With RCRA, there are listed wastes that have the D-codes, and then there's the characteristic waste that's ignitable, corrosive, toxic, that there are certain tests that you would need to do to show that it is a RCRA waste. Whereas if it's a non-RCRA or California-only hazardous waste, well, that's kind of the other part of it.
Yeah, although with the listings, testing is not required.
Yeah.
But that's the benefit of the listing, although it's pretty unbending and cool in its application.
So I bring this slide up, the retrograde material. It's something that's undergone a chemical or biochemical physical change due to the passage of time. It's either exceeded or specified recommended shelf life, or it becomes banned by law or regulation or ordinance and can't be used. And this is actually the one that kind of kicks in. It cannot be used for reasons of economics, health, or safety, or environmental hazard. Now, the thing with retrograde is that it's a hazardous material which cannot be used, sold, or distributed for use in its originally intended purpose, right? So it's something that's no longer usable for what it was intended, but it may be usable for something else. It could be something that can be put back into the manufacturing process, or
but as
you can do something.
It must be used by the manufacturer,
right,
or owner in specified ways for it to bypass the hazardous waste system.
I'm sorry, back up?
Yeah.
Okay, go to the next one, I'm sorry.
This one?
Where were you? The one you were just on.
That was it.
Go
this one?
That one.
Okay. So retrograde material does not include material designated in regulations adopted by the department as included in a category, which is, though these are the commercial chemical products or off-spec species, container residues, spill residues, those are not considered retrograde.
If by the following.
Right. Used in a manner constituting disposal and not normally used in a manner.
Number two is? Wait, where's number two?
Oh, we didn't put that on there.
Why not? Is there something?
Good question.
What is number two? I don't really want to know what number two is.
Well, Ed didn't like it.
Burn for energy recovery, something like that.
Yeah, that's exactly. It was just not how.
Everything's happening.
People are curious, people want to know these things.
So surplus material is defined as unused raw material or commercial product from a person who intended to use or sell it, but no longer needs it and transfers ownership to another person for use.
So this would essentially be unsold retail products in a general sense, would make it into the surplus
it could
material
be.
Arena?
Yeah, could be. It's neither.
But that doesn't necessarily imply it's a waste, right?
Right.
It's just a definition kind of point.
Right.
Okay.
But
yeah.
A surplus material can also be retrograde, even though that says.
No, a surplus material
neither
is neither retrograde or recyclable material.
I guess I'm confused by that.
Yeah, recyclable materials and retrograde materials are in the realm of hazardous waste.
Waste.
They are waste. But you're allowed to have.
They're exits to
the.
Yeah.
I guess I was just thinking of surplus material. Prior to the year expiring of a retrograde, it's a surplus material during that year.
Yeah, okay. There's a nuance to the retrograde. Definitely.
And, sorry.
I know that we have this over our time and we want to get through everything, but maybe we can put a pin in talking more about retrograde.
Sure. Jay, you got a command repeat performance.
Okay. So did you have a specific question on retrograde?
I think we just want to explore it more,
yeah,
not today.
And I don't think we have time, Jay, so I'd like to let's put bookmark there and let's return to it.
Right.
At a future meeting.
So no.
Is there anything else?
No, that's it.
That's it?
Yeah. And then the last is the end user definition. A person who receives hazardous waste from an affiliated third party who tends to or does use or reuse that waste as an ingredient. So,
all right. Thank you.
Jay, thank you. Thank you, Jay.
We made it hard for you.
Yes, yeah.
We were challenging groups.
There's never an easy presentation in this group, trust me. And this topic is obviously always very exciting and draws a lot of attention and discussion. Again, thank you all for your patience and tolerance, especially for those who've borne with us all day long. We look forward to meeting with the steering committee in 2 weeks. Where we're going to return to some of these very topics in a very interesting and stimulating discussion. Appreciate the presentation earlier on donations.
Mm-hmm.
We definitely, like I said, I know that we've been a number of questions, and there's some key issues in terms of some of the criteria that I think we'll be interested in kind of developing around some of the donation pathway. So
great.
If we can follow up with you later, that would
please
be great.
Do.
And if any other questions, concerns, issues, useless topical points that we want to make on the ladder.
No, it's a
Larry.
Long list.
So this is Michael Steele. I just want to say thank you to everybody, and also warn anyone who's heading towards the airport that there is a massive traffic jam on 5 northbound.
So if you're heading.
All right.
See you, Scott. Thank you all. Appreciate it. See you next time.